Sunday, Hope and Human Service tonight. Your newsletter calendars are either up front or back there or both. Check with Harry if you could help with the Calvary Men's Mission meeting on September 20th. He's got the menu. We will know about team read after next week, correct? There's still about 25 Boston butts available for sale. And Janet would like a few words on the food and faith ministry.
Good morning. Back in May, there was we kind of did a campaign about the Kroger Rewards, the community rewards card. We had 21 households that signed up, and I want to let you know, I'm so excited, that I received word a couple weeks ago from Kroger, and the church, remember I said it was going to be free money, all we had to do was sign up your card and link it to the church. The church received a check this week for $112.69.
Lifting up our voices in thanksgiving, sharing our this time of worship, that we might truly celebrate worshiping you together. Amen.
Our opening hymn this morning is number 77, How Great Thou Art. We'll sing all four verses of number 77.
Sing, O Lord, the words I hear.
join me with our Psalter on page 795, 72, 1 through 8.
Defend the needy and the poor, let justice and peace abound.
Give to King your justice, O God,
and your righteousness to the royal son.
May he judge your people with righteousness,
and your Lord with justice.
Let the mountains bear prosperity for the people, and the hills in righteousness.
May he defend and cause the poor of the people, give deliverance to the needy, and crush the oppression.
May he live while the sun endures, as long as the moon throughout all generations.
May he be like rain for all the mowing grass, like showers that water the earth.
In his days may righteousness flourish and peace abound, till the moon be no more.
May he have dominion from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth.
If you join me, please, for our statement of faith, the Apostles' Creed on page 881. I believe in
God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Sends her love to you and says she misses you. kind of kicking her butt. That's her word for them. Okay? Which, if you've ever had surgery and you've had rehab, you understand exactly what she is saying. So, in regards to her, she continues to seek your prayers and your continuing love. Are there other voices this morning to be raised? No? Most holy and gracious God, we offer our thanksgiving this morning that we can come from the different points of our communities to this place wherein we can gather together in fellowship in a time of worship and celebration unto you. Where we can come, O God, to learn more and to understand more in reference to your generosity and your love for us, and hopefully in return, our response and our living into lives of discipleship, as have been many lives lived from the centuries of our beginning and origin of faith to current day. May we strive to become like those faithful disciples of each and every generation. We thank you too, O God, that we can come and as a family of faith share and lift our voices in song and praise unto you. For indeed we seek to proclaim, O God, the very essence of our faith. And then too, we welcome these moments we can turn to you in conversation and prayer. And in the personal feelings of our spirit and our hearts, lift the innermost thoughts of our minds and our beings. While at the same time, as a community of faith, we raise our voices collectively, lifting up Melanie's family, lifting up Darlene's, lifting up Patty's family, and responding in the quietness of this moment, of God, with every other heart that is here, who may have offered a voice of praise or thanksgiving or concern. We too welcome this moment, of God, that we can pray for our pastor and for her well-being and the fullness healing we brought to her, both in terms of her physical body and the journey of her spirit in these days. We pray too this morning, O God, for our world, a world that stands in many respects restless, unforgiving, tattered and torn, because peoples just like ourselves would prefer to be angry or to lash out or to fight and even to maim and kill versus sitting down with their neighbor and in conversation learning how to love and to offer peace to one another. Still each heart, O God, and move us in the ways of your peace. And then as we come to the closing of this moment, we pray for our time together of service this morning, that there will be some aspect of hymns, our voices of thanksgiving and praise, our collective thoughts, the sermon of the morning, the opportunity for us and our children to learn, and our giving to you, that some part of this service will touch the life of each one who is gathered here. O God, we lift our voice in prayer in the name of your Son, who in the teaching of his disciples have likewise taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give to us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our hymn for preparation today is number 399, Take My Life and Let It Be. We'll sing all three verses, number 399.
When they leave, want the choir lights on.
Ceaseless prayer.
just about got everybody, right? Well, that's pretty good. Give yourself a round of applause. We want to thank you all. Now you can have a seat for a bit. All right? What did the day sound like?
She gets some flack.
Like the ball we had to play. What did you have to do? You had to what? Do what Simon says. You had to follow the directions that Simon gave, right? And you had to do something, correct? All right, well, that reminds me a lot of the scriptures we're about to hear. We're going to hear some scriptures read this morning, and these scriptures, it tells us a lot of things to do, all right? But one of the things it says, I'm going to look at verse 22 today in the scriptures that we're reading that says, but be doers of the word and not merely hearers, all right? Some of you did not hear me, so you didn't do the right thing, right? Well, that's when we come to church. We come to church, we hear the songs, we hear the preacher, we sing, we do what all this stuff, we meet up with good Christian folks, and then we don't remember. We've heard all this stuff, we know what the Bible says, now it's time to become doers, okay? Doers of the word, not just listeners. When you come to church, you're all treated as listeners. You hear the songs, you hear the scriptures being read, you hear the preacher talking, you hear what's said in Sunday school. But now what we've got to do is we've got to take what's being said and we've got to start doing it in our life so that we become the doers of the word and not just the hearers of the word. So this week, that's what I want you to do. I want you, as you do church today, remember, hear something today in church, and this week, what are you going to do? Do it. All right? So let's try that. Let's take a prayer together. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray for these children, Lord, that they have the open ears to hear your word, Lord.
This morning's lesson is from the New Testament, James 1:17-27. Every generous act of giving, with every perfect gift, is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers, who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word, and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror. For they look at themselves, and on going away immediately forget what they were like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, by doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God, the Father, is this, to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the word. Pardon. By the world. This is the word of God for we, people of God.
Thanks be to God.
people in our community can have a chance to view our services and to worship with us. And that's a great ministry that Curtis and others have helped to begin. Ginger, would you come back down and we might do the spiritual gymnastics that you just did with the children? I have a feeling that our congregation might understand that sermon better than mine. But you're going to have to talk a little bit slower, because I was still on the third thing you were doing when you threw your hands up and down and told them they all had to sit down. And my ears didn't quite travel as quickly as your emotions and your voice, and so it took me a while to catch up. But you are often, as the lady said, so on target. And as it happened, I just said, in a very beautiful way, not just a simplistic way, because it wasn't. It was very complex. Although the children caught them pretty quickly, some of us adults may have been just a little bit slow. You captured the message.
She's a school teacher. She does that every day.
Now, I and Lee, if she gets back, we're inviting you to journey with us through this letter of James. And so I want to take just a moment to make a few opening statements in reference to the letter as a whole. And then I want us to move into kind of the readings of the morning. James is offering for you and me, the reader, a moral exhortation. As Ginger said, in a much better word, he's giving us instruction, rules, so to say, as to how we are to live our life. James is also seeking to persuade in this letter you and me to to live into a profession of our faith. And you have heard Lee and other pastors before her many, many times when there has been a baptism, either an infant baptism or an adult baptism, to invite you to turn to page 39 or one of the other baptismal services in the front of our hymnal. And as a part of that, you as a congregation, as well as that family who may be bringing their child or a young person to be baptized, we are asked there to not just affirm our faith, which we stated in the Apostles' Creed this morning, but to live our faith. And that's what Ginger was saying to the children. Don't just hear what you're being asked to do, but go and live into it. Don't just profess a word, but go and live into that word, that affirmation, that profession of faith that is yours and mine. And then the writer of James also offers to you and to me what I will call a voice of practical wisdom in reference to right behavior, and invites you and me to wrestle with the reality of life. And that reality of life is kind of a dual, what word am I looking for? Kind of a dual ethical wrestling match. Between that which is right within the world and that which is right in reference to God. And we see and live that daily, folks. When we see the ongoing, continuous struggles among peoples, nations, or individuals and sometimes even within families, over the issue of power. Who's in charge? Who's on top? And we see that daily within our world in reference to that. How many of you went into mourning the early part? You know, when the stock market tumbled almost 1,000 points, some of you probably went into mourning because you lost money. I saw where one guy lost right at $1 billion. But you know, when you have $39 billion, what's the loss of one? But it was about greed. That's why if you have a good person who's helping you with your investment, they tell you, be long-term. Why? Because the world is going to be like that ball that used to be tied with that elastic band to the wooden paddle that many of us, when we were growing up, kind of tried to keep hitting and hitting and hitting. And every time, what's that ball doing? Going out, coming back, going out, coming back. Well, that's the stock market, folks. It's constantly a yo-yo. Or that ball on that elastic piece of thread that's going up and down and up and down and up and down. And you got to ride it for the long haul. Well, you know, James is talking to you and me about that very thing. We cannot get caught up and captured in the ways of the world. We have to stay steadfast. We are told that probably the writer of James, it is the brother of Jesus, who was selected to head the Jerusalem Council in those early decades of the Christian movement. We had not become a religion. We had not become a church. We were simply a movement. And yet, once James had found his own personal faith in reference to his journey, he became a leader and an apostle in the context of a movement. And we believe that this letter was written fairly early in those days, early days of the movement, where he is helping you and me to hear and understand what we see, that we then live it out as true disciples. Now that's the background upon which you and I are going to journey, and possibly to lead, as she continues to improve in her health over these next 4 or 5 weeks, as we read portions of and focus on portions of this letter of James. But this morning I want us to go to that portion which was read for us as our text of the morning, and to which Ginger alluded to in her time children. But I want to take us there by asking you to travel with me in your mind. I know that's a dangerous thing for some of you, but if you can, join me as we make that journey. I want you to go with me to my daughter's home. Robbie and Harry live on what I call the back side, or the north side, of Barton. They have bought a home there. She teaches in the community, and though he works outside that community, that's the place where they have chosen to raise their son, Ben. And as any and all young couples do when they buy that first house, they want to be very cautious as well as very intentional in how they began to furnish that house. Because they're making a healthy investment in terms of you buy a house and you put furniture in it and those kinds of things. That's a huge investment for any couple, but especially for a young couple. And so for those first few months, Robbie and Harry did not have any artwork on their walls. And I'm one of those old heads, okay, that through my journey of the years, I have bought a lot of art. I've got paintings by people from around the area, paintings of, from other areas of the world. I've got, limited edition prints, those kinds of things. I've got art stored under beds. I've got art that has never been framed. And so I thought, I can share some of my art with Robin and Anna so that they can begin to have things on their wall. So behind you yesterday, Janet, is a very nice painting and picture, which you probably don't remember, but it's lots. It's very colorful. It's a woman from Gay Paris, and in all of the awesome colors of that day. But if you were sitting there where Janet was sitting, and you're looking across kind of the breakfast room into the den, there will be another painting in an old barn wood frame. And to either side of that are two enlarged photos. And they are photos of children where Robbie and Harry have gone on mission trips with Zach. Where'd y'all go, Zach? Huh? Nicaragua, to El Yunta, right? Well, many, many years ago, the church where I was pastoring in Nashville, we also did those kinds of mission trips. And instead of going to Nicaragua, we went to Panama. And we would go back year after year to the same place. It was a community of Panamanian Indians up in the mountains. And we helped them to build a church, a schoolhouse, a residence for the pastor, and some things like a well and other things that the village needed. We would send those who would be leaders in reference to professing our faith, as well as those who could work with their hands in laying block or putting on roofs or what else. And we joined other BIM teams, volunteers in mission, to the United Methodist Church in going to those places to be in mission. Our church adopted that little village of Panamanian Indians. And of course, what is their predominant language down there? I bet my wife does. What would be their predominant? Spanish. That's right. Because they were a Spanish colony, like a lot of other colonies in Central and South America and the Caribbean. And so there was a lady in the church that I was serving who worked at Vanderbilt University, and she was a Spanish teacher and also a person who worked through Vanderbilt Medical Center for those families who were coming in who were Hispanic families from all across various countries who could not speak English. And so oftentimes she would be that person interpreting for the patient to the staff that was trying to treat her and then return the doctors and staff back to the patient. And she went further into her degree and eventually became a sociologist and psychologist, so that she ultimately could work just there at Vanderbilt. But she had two sons in college. She was a divorcee. And to be able to survive and do the things that she needed for survival, and to put her two sons through college, she had no extra money. But she came crying one day to my office and said, "Ken, I would just do anything if I could go with the team to Panama this next year." And her name was Roseanne. And I said, "Roseanne, you plan on going next year. Don't know how we'll swing it, but we'll make it happen. But I want you to promise me something. And this is the way you're going to pay for your trip." She said, "How's that?" I happen to know know that you are an artist. I want you, while you're there, to take your camera with you and take photos. And when you come back, I want you to paint some of those photos so that this congregation can see through your eyes how we are being in mission in a place that the vast majority will never go. I can do that, she said. I said, I want a minimum of 20 portraits over the course of the year after you get back. And they don't have to be picture perfect. You know, whatever medium you choose, the church will buy your supplies for you to paint. The canvas, because I mean, she didn't have to make anything. The paints, the brushes, those kinds of things. And she said, oh no, I could not ask the church to do that. Well, then you can't go. That's the deal. You either have to take it, or you have to leave. So I went to two of my friends there in the church, and I said, here's the deal, guys. We've had a request, and I've made a responding statement. And I told them just basically what I've told you. I said, I'm willing to go one third of that cost. Will you all match me and cover a third each for it to happen? And they both sent me to them. Yes. When I've told you that long story, which has eaten up a lot of my time this morning, because it's important. Because you see now, as you're sitting in the chair where Janet was sitting yesterday afternoon, one of the pieces that she painted is hanging on the wall over there. It's of two young Panamanian Indian boys. Both are sitting there in t-shirts and short pants. And between them is a pair of boots. But both boys are barefoot. She came back and immediately took another few days off and went to her studio to paint. Not a finished product, but to paint the portraits in her mind, because when she got there, her camera would not work. And so in her mind, she captured some 30 portraits that she said, if I don't get them sketched out and painted, I will lose them, and I will not be able to fulfill the contract that I've made to God and to this church. And so we went to the furniture store and got big, huge cardboard boxes, and we simply started cutting out cardboard squares of different sizes or rectangles, and she started painting. And as she was painting this portrait, or series of portraits, as I would go by, the one that captured me was of the two boys and the pair of boots. And she finished it on cardboard, and I said, I want that. Oh, Miss, no, it's not finished. I've got to put it on the canvas. I said, Roseanne, it's finished. I want it. And I took it and I framed it in an old barnwood frame. And I hung it in my office. Because I knew there had to be a story behind that piece. And so I said, Roseanne, I want to know the story. Dr. Ken, it was two boys there in the village. And throughout the week, I kind of became friends with them and would talk with them. Because they kind of reminded me of my two sons when they were younger. And for some reason, I just kind of attached myself and what little bits of free time and so forth that we had. And I would sit with them. And throughout the course of the week, one little boy had a pair of boots. And the other little boy was always barefoot. And in the course of the week, both wearing their shorts and their t-shirts, and I don't remember all the colors of shorts or t-shirts because we had seen a lot of folks down there, but I do remember the boots. And then one afternoon, I saw the two of them sitting over to the side by themselves. And I heard the little boy who had no boots, with tears running down his face, say to his friend, "One day I hope to have a pair of boots." And the other little boy took off his boots and he put them there next to the one who had no boots. And he said, who had no boots, now I have boots. And the one who had boots no longer had boots. He was hearing the word that was being offered about how God is a generous God. He was hearing the word about how if we are to be followers of God, then we've got to give of whom we are and what we have to our neighbor, whether we know them as our best friend or whether they are an absolute stranger. He heard that word, which says, above all other things, we are to love God and love God. His faith into works. And that's what James is saying to us. You can't just be one who sees and hears and talks and not live it out. You can't just be one who says, "Oh yeah, I believe in God. Oh yeah, the church is important to me in my life. And oh yeah, I happen to go most Sunday mornings," and let it stop there. Because if you do, you have become nothing more than a gallery Christian. It's like one who is sitting on the sidelines watching a battle between two contenders. And you're cheering on, and in some sense you're almost thinking that you could and would do this, and if you were, you would do this. Wait a minute, football season's coming up, right? Don't look like you don't know what I'm talking about. How many armchair quarterbacks do we have in here? We have a bunch, but y'all aren't willing to show me your names. Okay? Yeah. We've always got the solution of why our teams have won on Monday morning after winning the game on Saturday afternoon or evening. And if they had just done this, or if the coach had played this guy, or had they just done that, okay, guess what we just are? We're armchair quarterbacks. We're gallery Christians. We've got all the answers and all of the solutions up here in our mind. That's that deep, deep faith. But we don't do anything. You realize that in any church you want to go to, whether it's this one, or the largest church in our community, or the largest church in this region, about 20% of that congregation will be doers of the faith. The other 80% of us will be gallery Christians. We've seen, we've heard, we've somewhat talked, Christians in reference to the church. James is saying to you and me this morning, that's not what God wants. And God's generosity is so great to you. Closing book. We've got an offering to take, don't we? We've got that stuff again. I invite those who will receive our offering to please come forth that we might share in the giving and the receiving of our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings. Thank you, God, for the blessings you have shared. Thank you, God, for the blessings now that we who have received will share in return of time, of talent, of presence, of prayer. Whatever the means that are ours, to share with you, our brothers and our sisters. Thank you. receive our benediction. May you remember each time that you go to put on your shoes the message of this morning. Be not a gallery.